floor against Bergman, puts it up and scores!
Celebrating their 25th reunion, help us welcome back the Flyin Illini.
The 89 team was the best basketball team ever. Of all the golden years of Illinois basketball, this was the team.
Coaches, players of our era, you mentioned Flyin Illini. Oh, man, that's my favorite team.
This 1989 team, I know it's the most exciting team I have coached and probably the same in the college game.
Let's hear it for your Flyin Illini!
We're gonna put it on your head. Getting out on the fast break, dunking, catching lobs, blocking shots, and you, all that comes in the Flyin Illini.
We had style. We were, I think, college basketball's first hip-hop team. We were athletic, we flew a lot and dunked, but people don't really understand how tough that team was, man. We were junkyard dogs, and we just didn't like losing.
Battle right past the Bardo. There goes Bardo, flight 35!
More than a quarter century has passed since the 1989 Flyin Illini took to the air and put Champaign, Illinois back on the college basketball map. A team remembered and adored for the cohesion of its collection of stars, all of whom called the land of Lincoln home.
To stay home and represent your home, that's what I like about it.
Most of the time, guys would be recruited by other colleges and leave the state. To get them to stay and commit to the University of Illinois was unheard of.
The city of Chicago spawned the headline recruits of the group. Lowell Hamilton earned Mr. Basketball runner-up honors in 1985, while Simeon's Nick Anderson and King's Marcus Liberty won the award in 1986 and 1987.
Well, when I came in 1975, they had recruited a black player out of Chicago and over a period of 5 years. There were four of us out recruiting, getting to know the coaches, and so I think it paid off because our Final Four team, every player lived within 3 hours of the campus, all in-state players.
When I walked in the gym and I would see Coach K or Joey Meyer or Bobby Knight, my goal was to out-recruit them. I knew that I knew more about those kids' personalities than they did.
Of course, Jimmy Collins had a long history with Lou. Jimmy Collins was the starting guard on that great New Mexico State team coached by Lou that went to the Final Four.
He had a lot of good contacts in Chicago, and he worked Chicago as well as anybody probably ever did.
Three on one. Here's Hamilton, big step.
Collins made it easy for me to choose the University of Illinois. Coolest cat in the world. And the nice thing is that he was able to relate to me and from where I was from.
We got a 4-on-2 here.
If Coach Collins wasn't a part of the University of Illinois staff, I would have never gone there. He was like a father figure to me.
And it's Liberty time.
Coach Henson would come too, but Jimmy Collins, and then you read up on Jimmy Collins that he actually played in the NBA as well. So you have guys that you can relate to because that's one day where you want to go.
The suburbs of Chicago supplied Kendall Gill, who guided Rich Central to the 1986 state finals, and Kenny Battle, who dazzled at West Aurora before beginning his college career at Northern Illinois.
When John McDougal got fired at Northern Illinois, him and Kenny Battle were very, very close. Battle was devastated. He decided that he wanted to leave.
Illinois was also on my list of schools to go to, and it was only a couple hours from my house as well. So my family still was able to get down to Champaign, watch all of my games for the next 2 years.
You know, being from the suburbs is a different world.
We heard about Kenny Battle. Nobody heard about Kendall Gill. That's why that's a different story within itself.
This is Gill.
No doubt about that one.
You know how they have McDonald's All-Americans? Well, they have a local chicken place around here called Harold's Chicken. I always tell everybody I was a Harold's Chicken All-American, okay? I didn't have all of the accolades that Nick Anderson, that Marcus Leary, that Steve Bartow, and all those guys had.
Far from the bright lights of the city were Carbondale's Stephen Bartow and Alton's Larry Smith, who joined Anderson, Liberty, and Gill on the 1986 high school All-State team.
When you're in the Chicagoland area, you kind of think that the world of Illinois basketball, high school basketball, revolves around Chicago. But, you know, when you saw Steve in person and Larry in person, you know, you're blown away by how talented they were.
Guys in Chicago think the universe is there. They've got a tremendous amount of pride. And what that does is that fuels guys like Kendall, Kenny Battle, Larry Smith, and myself to come in and prove ourselves.
Charged with blending this charismatic group, the straight-laced Lou Henson, still seeking his first trip back to the Final Four since his magical run with Jimmy Collins and New Mexico State in 1970.
No-nonsense guy, okay? He's a guy that teaches you lessons as you go along.
He never said a cuss word, but he could make you feel so small without even cussing you. You know, he'd say you wasn't worth the salt in your own bread.
They believed in Coach, but he could hurt their feelings. And I told her, hey, man, that's not an act. That's him. That's the way he is. When he tells you to run through a wall, don't ask him why. Just run through the wall. Something good is going to happen from that.
I try not to let Coach Henson down because he's just a wonderful guy. And he used to tell me, Nick, I want you to go in there. I want you to be rough and tough and get every rebound. You know, he's pointing that finger. That's because he believed in me.
Bartow gets it in. Norman at the buzzer. No good. Austin Peay has upset Illinois.
A stunning first-round upset by Austin Peay in 1987 and a second-round loss against Villanova the following season amplified the volume of Henson's critics.
Just the two worst losses in Illinois history. For me, the loss to Villanova was much more serious because of the potential of the 88 team to go further in the tournament. In my opinion, this team could have gone to the Final Four very easily.
After that loss, everybody stayed at summer school that year. So everybody stayed down in Champaign and we all worked out. And I think that that's how we became better.
Kendall, before that season began, he says that we got something special here. We're that good. We all could make some money, but we have to do something now.
We knew that we had special teams, special players, special talent. It just needed to be all put together.
The Illini boasted a cast of the state's most decorated high school players. But the legendary Ben Wilson, who led Simeon to the 1984 state championship as a junior, was the one that might have been.
Ben Wilson would have met one national championship and another Final Four appearance at least. I wouldn't have started. And I would have gladly done it because Ben was so talented.
Me and Ben, we talked all the time. I mean, I would spend a night over Ben's house. He would stay the night over my house, and we had a plan. And we both said that we were gonna go to the same school. We were gonna take care of our mom and dad and our families. And play basketball.
One of the best players that I ever had an opportunity to recruit. As you know, that recruitment and his life ended way too soon.
Apparently, he was on his way home from school, slight altercation, a bump in with some local youths, and one of them produced a gun and shot him twice.
Thank you, Ben! Thank you for your excellence! For coming this way.
You have angels, you know, and I believe Ben is one of our angels.
I think about it to this day. He wasn't able to fulfill that plan that we had, and I felt it was my duty to fulfill what we talked about doing. I told them that
I wanted 25, and I wasn't putting on any other jersey if the number wasn't 25. And Coach C, like, it's yours. And as I sit here today, I have never, ever worn another number.
I made a promise to myself that I was going to come back and I was going to be one of the best players in the Big Ten.
We would go to the campus rec center at night. He would shoot for an hour. I would rebound. And, you know, he wouldn't want to leave.
He was always first in sprints. He kind of went from benching like 135 to now he benching 225.
By the time I came back, I felt that I was one of the best players on the team. You know, because I had worked so hard and I felt that there was nobody to really compete with me. So hard work just pays off.
Ranked ninth to start the season, Illinois quickly put the nation on notice, humbling several top 20 teams, beginning with Big Dwayne Schentz's and the Florida Gators.
We was never a team that feared size because we knew that size come with slowness and we utilize our athletic ability as well as our speed.
He couldn't deal with Lowell Hamilton's speed going up and down. He couldn't deal with Kenny Battle coming and knocking his shot out of the air, and Kenny only being 6'6".
We pressed 94 feet. By halftime, you could see them guys was wore down. Legs were gone. Come the second half, it wasn't even a contest.
The Illini's next event came on neutral ground, with bragging rights on the line against 10th-ranked Missouri.
The bragging rights game is always a great kind of a temperature taker or milepost marker, try to figure out where you're at. Those were really wars.
They had us on the ropes. I mean, we were struggling early. Shots weren't falling. It was like they were hitting everything.
There's a reason why we have the Kenny Battle Award at Illinois to this day, and some of it is based upon just the toughness and the unique aspects that he brought to our team.
I can remember being down 18 against Missouri in St. Louis, and this guy just wheels us back by himself, you know, and then we follow his lead.
Coach Henson really got on us, you know, and so you guys always talk about you want to be good, you want to be great. Well, here's an opportunity to show the whole world how good you guys can be. And we just buckled down defensively. We got stops.
He got a couple steals. He got some layups. Got the crowd going, got us energized, and Missouri was in trouble after that.
87-84, 1 second. The game is over. Illinois has won. Illini win. Illini win. Illini win. There is bedlam on this court.
I think the greatest game ever played there in St. Louis by Illinois and Missouri, and they've had some good ones, but I that's number one for me. 87-84, Illinois pulled it out, and the battle was a star.
Three days after beating one set of Tigers, Illinois visited Baton Rouge to take on another. LSU and their freshman superstar, Chris Jackson.
Quickest release I'd ever seen. And Irvin Small was kind of talking to him, trying to get under his skin, and we were like, Irvin, shut up, man. This dude was lighting us up.
We fouled out with 9 minutes to go, had 27 points. You know how happy Steve and I were? Because if he had stayed in, he may have 40.
We hit a lot of open shots. We got out on the break. You know, we really dominate them, forced them into an up-tempo game.
We were making all of our shots, and our second team shot better than the first team. After the game, Dale Brown, being a friend of mine, he said, Lou, I really appreciate you attempting to hold down the score, which we did.
The game is over. The Illini win it by the phenomenal score of 127-100.
Think about that. We had 127 points, and he's thanking us for not running up the score. I knew right then that we had a chance to be special.
And look at Illinois run right now.
By mid-January, the Illini soared to number two in the country, dominating both ends of the floor thanks to a roster of seemingly interchangeable and positionless parts.
They were all basically the same size, but they were very skilled. They were tough. And all of them were extremely athletic.
We were a short, small team, but man, we were tenacious. Lowe can get out on the break.
He has sweet jump shot, you know, nice left and right hook in the lane. You know, he proved a matchup problem for a lot of teams because you didn't know how to guard him.
Bardo is back and he stripped the ball. Holy cow, what a play.
I like shutting guys down. I could lock anybody up, and that's I took pride in that.
Anderson on the move.
Anytime we need a basket, we know, like the Chicago Bulls used to go to Michael Jordan. Well, Nick Anderson was our Michael Jordan.
We knew that we can get a rebound, any one of us. You just run your fast breaks, run your lanes. We already knew that because we had the confidence in one another that we can get the job done.
Anderson up high for the rebound.
Illinois glided through their first 16 games undefeated. And when top-ranked Duke fell to North Carolina, the Illini had a chance to claim the number one ranking for the first time since 1952. Standing in the way, a home clash with Georgia Tech on Super Bowl Sunday.
We knew if we won, come Monday, we'll be the number one team in the country. And they came out and played like they were the home team. Dennis Scott could shoot the ball from the locker room. I don't think we played as well as we were capable of playing. It was a dog fight.
That's battle. He got it, and he is fouled.
Trailing by 16 points in the second half, the Illini rallied to regain the lead. The final second saw Georgia Tech tie the score and a season-changing injury for the Orange and Blue.
At first, I thought it would go away. You know, I thought it would be, you know, just the pain that was there for, at that point in time, for maybe a couple minutes. But in the overtime period, I came back out and I tried to run. It felt like somebody was driving a nail through my foot.
We literally had him try to tie his shoe tighter to see if that would help him get back into the ball game. And he gave it a valiant effort, went back out there, but only took a few extra steps and found out that, you know, he wasn't going to go.
A 13-0 Illini run in double overtime finally extinguished the Yellow Jackets.
Bardo to Smith, bounces for Battle, slam dunk Battle, and he's fouled!
Woo! When Kenny Battle had that emphatic dunk to really seal the game, that was one of the happiest moments of my basketball career because, you know, we're the number one team in the country, man.
There it is. Good night. Slam Jam Bam, number one in the nation, the Flyin Illini.
It was a roller coaster of emotions because we won. It was Super Bowl Sunday. We're excited. We know we're going to be number one in the country. We walk in the locker room and Kendall's in tears.
I thought maybe it was sprained, but when they took my shoe off and it was black and purple, I knew that it was broken.
And we're the number one team in the country, but are we really number one without Kendall Gill? It was a bittersweet situation.
You hurt for him because you know how hard he worked, how many hours he put in, how big he got, how strong he got. And now for him to be derailed, it was a pretty tough pill to swallow.
I mean, you can look at your hands, you have five fingers. You know, which one of the fingers are most important? That was like losing Kendall, losing a finger. And it took something away from us. We weren't used to that.
This bone right here is the fifth metatarsal. And the fracture occurs right in the area right here.
A lot of people don't know this. I did the regular rehab, but I was sort of going to a witch doctor too on the side, and this guy was doing all kind of stuff, using these Chinese remedies with my foot.
There was a healer that would place his hands on his on injured area and just keep it there for a while, and his skin would start to turn colors.
He was doing something like this where he would, you know, he and his wife, they told me that, listen, we can help you with your foot. We can help you heal it up faster. And at that point, I would have taken anything because I just wanted to get back on the court and play.
Now the number one team in the land, the Illini played three of the next four games on the road without the services of Kendall Gill.
Anytime you lose a guy that was quick as Kendall, could shoot the ball with accuracy from outside, you know, anytime you lose that threat, you know, it's going to hurt.
And unfortunately for the Illini, then they had to go to three of the toughest places to play on the road in the Big Ten, starting with Old Williams Arena with the elevated court and the draftiness and a pretty good Gophers team.
A happy bunch of Gopher fans in Minneapolis tonight.
That team was a Rolls Royce. If you had taken any piece out of that team, then that would have happened the very next game. We were a machine, a fine-tuned machine that was missing one of the pieces, and that's why we lost.
The Big Ten was loaded that year. I mean, it was a tremendous league. And all three of those games were close games, and we lost all of them.
Also weighing on the team's mind, a car accident that seriously injured the mother of Nick Anderson.
My mom broke all her ribs. She broke both of her legs and one of her arms. When you hear something like that, you go numb, speechless.
I know I was there for Nick, and I know a lot of other guys were there for Nick because Nick's mom would come to the games, and she was like our mom. And when Nick told us that news, we were all in shock because it seemed like a part of us was in that accident, too, because of that.
Coach Collins was always there. Coach Nagy, I'll never forget, with those big hands, he used to come and grab me around my neck and just tell me everything gonna be all right, you know?
In the face of adversity, the Illini regained their stride thanks to the emergence of two players who capably combined to fill the void of Gill's absence. Larry Smith displayed superior passing skills, and Marcus Liberty's all-around game began to flourish.
I didn't feel any pressure at all because the players didn't. They kept giving me more and more confidence, like, Marcus, it'll be okay. Just keep going, keep playing. And eventually, everything will click and gel.
You had to guard him from the outside. He can get around you because of his quickness, and he can finish at the basket. I think Marcus got better with the more minutes that he got. We had to gather ourselves after we lost our leader in Kendall. So when he went out, Larry Smith got more minutes.
I was playing pretty good ball at the time. I was getting 17, 18 minutes a game. I just figured, I'm like, well, now I'm going to get the start. But that didn't happen. He went with Marcus, it's fine. I'm still going to get my minutes.
Larry was really creative, and Larry could break down defense much better than I could. And so Larry would sense an opportunity to catch and go. And he'd go looking to dish or to score. He should have been a 12, 14-year NBA veteran. He was that talented.
As the Illini began the final week of the regular season at Indiana, Kendall Gill's return was on the staff's mind as much as matching wits with Bobby Knight.
Before the game, I took Kendall and two other walk-ons over to the Indiana court, and I worked out Kendall hard, just me and him and the two walk-ons and Rod Cardinal, for an hour.
We could afford to spend a little more time and push him a little bit more. And we went over early to the gym and put him through a pretty rigorous workout, of which he left the court smiling.
Gill would remain on the sideline as the 8th-ranked Illini would play a game for the ages against the number 3 Hoosiers in Bloomington.
Illinois played really well, and this is an outstanding Indiana team. They'd won the national championship in 87. This is 2 years later, and they're still loaded.
We were the most exciting show in college basketball that season. And I was this lucky kid who had a front row seat to the whole show. And that Indiana game is just kind of like the exclamation point for how exciting it could be.
Illinois went down big until they got one of their explosions, as they like to call them, one of the runs. They got him back into the game.
Inside the battle against Eric Anderson. Yes, foul.
Trailing by double digits midway through the second half, Illinois authored an unforgettable comeback, storming their way to a 2-point lead until Indiana's Jay Edwards got the ball in the final seconds.
Edwards going to try to get a screen. Gets it off.
Step back, going out of bounds, and I just tried to stretch up, and I tried to disturb the shot. It just didn't look like it would be a shot that someone could make.
Goes over the backboard and hits nothing but cotton. You couldn't play any better defense. Lowell was in his jock, but he hit the shot.
So we have 2 seconds to go. We call timeout, and we run a play for Nick to get the shot.
I told Nick Anderson I knew he shot better off of a bounce. And I said, get the ball, and you've got time to take a bounce and shoot it.
I hit him right on stride. And Nick being so strong, people don't remember how strong Nick was. He shot a jumper. That wasn't a push.
The
Remember, the clock doesn't stop.
Anderson! Oh, I can't believe it now! Nick Anderson hit the shot! Oh! Incredible! Big Ten basketball! Super, super, super key!
I caught it. I turned right into it, just like a regular jump shot, and I let it fly. And when it left my hand, and the height and the rotation on the ball, I said, this is good. And it was all bottom. And to see the look on the Indiana bench, it was worth more than $1 million. And they dubbed the shot in the nick of time. What more can you ask for?
Long, long jumper, Anderson. Good! Anderson hits it! Anderson hits it! Anderson hits it! Illinois wins! Illinois wins! Illinois wins!
When it hit, I mean, pandemonium broke out in the gym.
They swarmed Nick when the game was over. It was one of the true highlights, not only of that season, but of a lot of seasons.
Everybody just jumped up and just stormed the court, and that's when I think we got our swag back. When that shot went in and everybody was like, boom, the next day in practice, we had practice and everything just started to click in jail. We started like having more fun and playing and getting along with each other, and the chemistry just got tighter and tighter.
Next up, Iowa. And after a 12-game absence, the return of a leader.
And there is Kendall Gill. He was the leader of a 17-0 team. They are 8-4 without him.
My foot was still hurting, but the x-rays revealed that the bone had grown over the crack in my stress fracture. I still didn't feel 100%, but this team was so special, I had to get back as soon as possible.
When he came back, it was like if you tear a sheet of paper and you paste it back together, you know, you're gonna see the ripples in that paper, but pretty soon it starts to hold.
We were so happy for him. He hit that first jumper, and it was on after that. We were like, okay, we're about to run the Hawkeyes out of the gym.
And the blocking foul called against Iowa. Look at Kendall Gill.
The regular season concluded with a battle of top 10 teams on Senior Day in Ann Arbor, where the Illini locked horns with a Michigan team the Orange and Blue had throttled nearly 2 months earlier in Champaign.
I'll never forget me and Kenny Battle and sitting on the bench, and we were saying that we're going to make their senior night bad for them.
There's the lob.
They thought they were better than us, vice versa. And, you know, a lot of trash talking going back and forth. And, you know, when you beat a team like that at home on senior day, it sends a message.
We knew we were on the road to the Final Four. So we had to send Michigan a message because we knew they were one of the best teams in the country as well. And we went up there and took them out. I mean, took them out.
This was over, and the Illini have won it in grand style here. The final is Illinois 89 and Michigan 73.
Michigan was not competitive on their own court. Illinois was just rolling by then. And I don't think any of us suspected that if we ever played Michigan again that we'd lose.
Being seated number one is a tribute to the outstanding young men we have playing for us.
The top seed in the Midwest region, Illinois sought to bury ghosts of tournaments past in Indianapolis with a victory over McNeese State.
There were a lot of questions. Is this going to be another Austin Peay moment, or is this team really as good as we think they are?
There's a lot of pressure in that first game. And McNeese State came out and played extremely well, but we caught our stride and, you know, had our little run there to get that gap, and then we were okay after that.
Standing between Illinois and the Sweet 16, a scrappy 29-win Ball State squad.
Good outlet pass.
Back to Gill.
And a chance for a three-pointer.
Ball State came in and, you know, they were gunning for us. They was testing, you know, our mentality.
It was a hard-nosed city game. I mean, they had Paris McCurdy and Curtis Kidd, both transfers. And those guys were Detroit tough guys.
We went back in the tunnel together. And Paris starts yapping and wants to square off and fight. He forgets. He's from Detroit. But our guy's from Chicago. And then we came out in the second half and ran him down.
So Illinois moves on to Minneapolis, and the dream ends
for Ball State.
The Illini moved on to Minneapolis for a Sweet 16 date against Louisville, where conditions inside the Metrodome immediately impacted Kenny Battle.
You gotta be kidding me. Water from the top of the roof on the floor? I mean, you gotta be kidding me.
The only thing that I remember like it was yesterday was standing there on the sidelines watching Kenny Battle go down on the, in that little pool of water.
I just heard a boom, and I looked and Kenny was laying on the ground, so I was like, oh my God, not at this, not now.
I didn't even think how bad it was. Number one thing was I wanted to get back on the floor.
He hobbled off the court and we started some treatment. He was a warrior and wouldn't give up, and there's no way we're going to keep him off the court.
Playing against Purvis Ellison. He is a guy that's been in the limelight since his freshman year in college and leading the Louisville Cardinals to the national championship.
LeBradford Smith, Felton Spencer, never nervous Purvis Ellison, and Kenny Payne. Four first-round draft picks in the NBA.
Battle was limited to 15 minutes against the talented Cardinals, and the injury bug struck again.
Well, Hamilton is down, and now Lowell's down on his face.
You never think these things are going to happen. And after grabbing the rebound, and when I realized that my foot wasn't on the ground yet, and it turned over, I said, this is it. Because I realized it just, it was more the ankle hitting the ground rather than my foot. And I was mad at Spencer. I said, man, why are you all up under me? Why now?
If there was any game that year that described the spirit of the Flyin' Illini, it was the Louisville game. That was it.
In my mind, the reason we beat Louisville was a guy named Irvin Small. It was a war between Purvis and Irvin Small.
Irvin's from the south side of Chicago. He always got an angle, okay? So his angle that game against Louisville is to get inside Purvis Ellison's head, talk to him anytime he can, score a couple baskets on him, hit him down low, do everything you can to get this man off his game, and he was quite successful at doing that.
If I got to guard this guy, the best thing for me to do is try to talk him out of his game and be a blanket on him. Be a blanket. I'm gonna push him around, I'm gonna foul him, I'm gonna use all my fouls, I'm gonna make him think I'm half crazy.
Nick Anderson poured in 24 points, and Marcus Liberty and Larry Smith provided key contributions, enabling the Illini to pull away and advance to their first regional final since 1984.
We executed very well offensively. Kendall was shooting the ball pretty well. Our defense was always a constant, and Nick Anderson was just on a tear. Nobody could stop Nick.
I think we used our ability to pressure full court. When we got the ball off the backboard, we ran. I don't think they could keep up with the running.
He passed to Larry Smith, going for the layup, and he dunks it.
How we ever beat Louisville, I don't know, because they had one of the great teams, maybe the best team in the country that year.
83-69, the Illini in the final eight. And they overcame all kinds of adversity in this game, and they were winning it going away.
I think people saw that game and they were like, they can beat Louisville, they can win it all.
Larry Smith's chance to celebrate his success was short-lived.
My brother comes to me. He's like, come here, man. He said, Mama had a stroke. She's going to be fine. She's resting comfortably. He said, go win for Mama on Sunday.
We just prayed about it. I said, hey, listen, Larry, she's going to be all right. Everything's going to be all right. Just give us, just, you know, give us what you got. Give us what you can.
As a clash with Syracuse in the Elite Eight loomed, trainer Rod Cardinal worked wonders to heal the walking wounded.
I moved Kenny and Lowell together into the same room and kept up the same treatment routine every couple of hours going in there, changing ice bags.
He would tape it up so well that I was able to at least move around a little bit. My ankle was this big. It was purple and black.
Two teams that have each won 30 games. The Illini are 30-4. Syracuse at 30-7. Kenny Battle against Derek Coleman.
This was the only team that the whole season, when we walked out on the court, I looked in their eyes and they weren't afraid of us.
Gill is on Coleman, but Coleman spins around against Gill and hits the little short jumper.
Yeah, Gill got knocked down. He got an elbow or something in the mouth, and he looked like he might be bleeding in the mouth.
Derek Coleman, and I still get on him to this day. Derek, you had the sharpest elbows I ever have experienced in my life. You know, and he hit me in my lip, and, you know, part of my lip was hanging off, and they actually had to cut it off. The piece that was hanging down in the locker room after the game.
Kenny Battle, the soul and the heart of his team.
Oh, dear! Put that in the highlight film.
There's a terrific game. So much flash. It was everything you'd thought it would be.
We knew that Syracuse was a good ball club. And the second half, we came alive and really played one of the best second halves we played all year.
Larry Smith to the left side, cut off, double team, throws for Battle, his shot is good. What a look that time by Larry Smith.
We got our A game going. When I say A game, I mean defense, rebounding the basketball, running in transition, playing good transition basketball, making it uncomfortable for them.
Gill gives to Owens, gets Battle in the air, Battle knocks it away to Anderson. Anderson coming down. Anderson lays it off to Battle. His shot is up and off the board. Missed. Tipped in by Kendall Gill over the top. Sensational follow-up goal by Gill.
They did not back down, and so Nick would come down and hit a big bucket. DC would get a bucket.
Douglas drives on Larry Smith. Cut off by Hamilton. Throws the ball away. Larry Smith to Battle. And a foul is called in the backcourt.
I think it was our time. In our moment, you know, and I think that when it all boiled down to it, our defensive schemes is what really got us over.
Illinois by four. Goes to the right side, goes for three. Douglas, and he hit it.
With Illinois nursing a one-point lead with 20 seconds remaining, Marcus Liberty stepped to the foul line with a chance to extend the lead.
It was a free throw that I was really trying to make, and when you have that big old background and shooting in a dome, you know, one of those big domes, it's really hard.
One and one. 20 seconds to go. It's up and it's way too hard. The rebound is fought for. Liberty gets it back. Gill, rather. Gill down the lane. Kendall to Battle. Bring it out, and Battle is fouled.
He went up and got that rebound, and it's, you know, he looked like he was 7 foot tall. He went to get it.
Battle at the line. His first is good. Battle.
I always play the game in my head prior to even stepping on the court and having the opportunity to be there and make those free throws. You know, it was something that you dreamed about and that ran through your mind over and over.
One more for Battle on the way, and good! Battle cans them both. 15 seconds to go. In it comes to Steve Thompson. 13 seconds. Thompson at the top of the circle for three. A left-hander on the way. Short. Rebound tipped. It goes to the corner. Gill has it! 6 seconds, 5 seconds, deep pass for Battle. Kenny drives the lane, lays it up, and lays it over. Illinois wins, Illinois wins, Illinois wins. Final four, final four, final four, final four, 89-86.
When I saw Kenny go in for the layup and I heard the buzzer go off, I laid down on the court, and that was the happiest moment. Besides my kids being born, that was the happiest moment of my life.
I didn't think it was going to be this good, but it feels good. Yes. We're working to get somewhere, and we're on our way.
We've had some outstanding teams, but not a team to get the Final Four since in the early 50s, so it means a lot to all of us.
It was amazing, man. The school had never seen nothing like this. They'd never been to the Final Four. It was just a big, like a burden to have been lifted off the university, man.
Ah, ooh, shoo-wop, 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 shoo-wop. Ah, ooh, shoo-wop, shoo-wop, shoo-wop,
shoo-wop. Ah, you say it's Kenny Battle.
Ah,
he's taking us to Oceano.
Ah,
when we get there.
Ah,
we're going to tear it up and rip it apart.
Ah,
Irvin was the orchestrator of that. You know, Irvin was always the one up front. Singing the shoo-wop, shoo-wop, and he did a good job. I mean, him and Kenny Battle, I think, actually loved it. I think Kenny Battle wanted to have a record deal off of that if he could.
Lowski will grab the rebound. Oh, Nick will jam it down.
cool, that's what we can do. Ow. Smart and Liberty will do it too. Ow. Oh, but I forgot old Coach Lou. Ow. He's the guy that's the head of the crew. Ow. Now I'm about to let you go. Ow. Seattle, we will be go.
That was the unity of that group. We were singing all the time, on the bus rides, on the plane, wherever we could.
Now, after we beat them, I really thought we were national champions. Now, I really thought that was a national championship game.
People were lined up outside of the airport, just, you know, wanting to celebrate with us, and you can feel it. We all thought that we were going to win a national championship.
Seattle, the Final Four, and a familiar foe, as the Flyin Illini clashed with conference rival Michigan for the third time in 3 months. The Maize and Blues sported a new look, with assistant coach Steve Fisher ascending to the head spot after Bill Frieder accepted the Arizona State job at the end of the regular season.
We went into that game knowing it was going to be tough, because when you play a team as good as Michigan is, you play them a third time, it's hard.
They had tremendous talent, 6 or 7 guys in the NBA, okay? When Bill Frieder left, regardless of who was going to coach those guys, they came together. It was like a breath of fresh air.
It'll be Mills jumping for Michigan and Battle for Illinois. The winner plays Seton Hall for the national championship.
The national semifinal lived up to the hype. Neither team ever built a double-digit lead, as Illinois searched for an elusive rhythm on both ends of the court.
We were strictly half court, if you watch the game. You know, we didn't get out on the fast break a lot.
They double-teamed Nick Anderson every time he got the basketball. We had not seen that all year.
We had our opportunities, as well as they did, to take a commanding lead. We just didn't do it.
Kenny Battle led all scorers with 29, but his front court mate, Lowell Hamilton, battled foul trouble and a bum ankle.
I believe that the outcome could have been different if I hadn't hurt my ankle, because I think I could have helped more.
He didn't have much lift. It was hard for him to get up and down the floor. He was hurt. He was hurting.
Illinois up by one. Robinson gets the ball to Rice. Long jumper is good.
Back up, Bobby.
Three-pointer.
Illinois couldn't contain Michigan's 1-2 punch of Ramil Robinson and Glenn Rice.
They crashed the boards and they didn't turn the ball over. And they didn't turn the ball because they gave the ball to Ramil, and Ramil just ran the offense.
I remember Ramil Robinson taking it to another level. I remember Glenn Rice being really hot.
I didn't talk to Glenn Rice like, no. This guy had decent success in our 2 wins, but he's a different player and he's hitting his stride. And so, man, no, I'm smart, man. I'm not saying nothing to Glenn Rice.
The Illini down by one with the ball with 1:57 to go. In the corner, Hamilton. Baseline jumper by Hamilton is good. Lowell Hamilton hands it from deep in the left corner.
As bad as we played, I don't think in our minds that we were thinking, hey, we're going to lose this game.
50 seconds on the clock. Michigan up by 2. 81-79, Illinois with the ball.
I knew if I touched it every time down, I was scoring or getting to the foul line. You know, I knew that. My teammates knew it. Coaches ran the offense through me.
Back to Bardo. The lob is for Battle. Turnaround jumper is off the board and good by Battle. And the score is tied at 81.
It was set for us to win the game. And at the last shot, the defensive scheme worked. And all we had to do was secure the rebound.
Now 14 seconds. Ramil drives left side on Bardo. Baseline, cut off.
It was kind of a hectic play from one side of the court to the other side. I know Terry took a, I'm not going to say a good shot, you know, from the corner in front of that bench.
Mills outside the three. It's Higgins.
You figure if Glenn beats you, you know, so what? If Ramil beats you, you know, all right, or even Terry. But it's Sean Higgins. No one saw that coming.
That broke my heart because that was my rebound. That rebound, that was a rebound that I get all the time. That rebound, I should have had, but I jumped too early. And Sean Higgins got it and did what he was supposed to do.
One of my former coaches, Chuck Daly, used to tell me, gotta make plays, gotta make plays. And that was a play that I should have made.
1 second on the clock. Let's see what Illinois decides to do.
When we started running to throw the ball in, Larry Smith stepped in front of the guy trying to run with the ball and got ran over.
He flat ran over us, and he didn't call it. And you should make that call at the end of the game just like you would at the beginning of the game.
Ref didn't call anything. And so I just let it heave and try to get it down to Kenny Battle.
And that's it. Michigan upsets Illinois. They'll play Seton Hall for a national championship.
You don't believe it. I didn't believe it. And but, you know, the horn and the score quickly settles in.
I mean, we were a better team than Michigan. And I know the proof was in the pudding twice. And then one time somebody took a spoon and dug out the pudding.
It brought tears to my eyes. I was hurt. I was in pain. But it just wasn't our time. It just wasn't our time, you know?
We didn't play the game that we've been playing as of late. Our defense wasn't really good. When it's over, you know, I congratulate them on a great year, and you can hold up your heads because it's just one of those things. It's a game, and we didn't play up to par, but you had a great season.
Nick was always struck me as a kind of a quiet guy, a mature guy. He literally was sitting in his cubicle, not in front of his cubicle. It was like he was hiding from the world. I mean, he just couldn't believe that's how that team was going to bow out.
I was one game away from getting that championship in college, so to speak, losing to Michigan. I think if we'd have got past that game, I think we'd won a national championship.
We had a special team, but it's one or two plays, Michigan's national champions, and we're flying a line out. We're the best team in the country that year, but the best team in the country doesn't always win the national championship.
The Flyin Illini left Seattle without the ultimate prize, but their return to Champaign showed the magnitude of their season would not soon be forgotten.
It was unbelievable. If you'd have been there, you'd have swore we had won the championship.
We kind of released a little bit of the, you know, the sadness that we had, you know, seeing all the fans coming in and filling the arena and cheering that we love you. You're one of the best teams that come through here in a very long time.
They may have missed their one shining moment, but the Flyin Illini's place among college basketball's great teams continues to endure.
I can honestly go back and say I played on one of the most exciting college teams in the history of college. We were exciting. People wanted to see us play.
I think the 1989 team, Flyin Illini, should be probably remembered as the best team ever at Illinois. It always helps to have a nickname. I mean, the Flyin Illini, you know, that'll be their name forever.
I've been stopped in Tokyo, Japan, and Barcelona, Spain by people I didn't know. If you're a college basketball fan and you're old enough to remember that era, that team sticks out as much as any team ever. Fab Five, UNLV teams, the Flyin Illini stands out as much as any of those teams.
It's a shame that the Flyin Illini doesn't have that championship banner to legitimize itself. It just goes to show you what personality and style means in sports and how it connects with people. And this team just connected with people. They just felt something. They made you feel a certain way.
People walk up to me and say, you know, that 89 team, the Flyin Illini, was the best college basketball team I've ever seen. And they say, I want to let you know I appreciate all the effort that you guys put forth. It was a team that's going to go down in history as one of the most memorable. I think Coach Henson made a mistake when he told us that we can design our own shorts.
Michael Jordan, Chicago Bulls, his shorts were always longer than other players on the team. So we saw that, and we wanted our shorts a little longer, too.
the style. You know, we had the baggy shorts, and, you know, I know that the guys at Michigan, you know, the Fab Five say, oh, we came up with the baggy shorts. Well, no, you didn't, okay?